Good afternoon. Now, see, I'm from this black church tradition of call and response. So when I give you some love, you got to give some energy back. Okay, let's try that again. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. It's great to be here. Today's topic, profit is power. So I'd love to begin, if I could, by sharing a little story. It's a story about a young girl, who, like too many of our young women today, found herself in a tough situation. She was pregnant and single. She was being raised by her aunt, and so they decided that the best thing to do was to go away, to head up north, and to have her child without shame. She also made another critical decision at that time in her life. She decided that she was unable to raise her child and that she was going to put her baby up for adoption. That baby was me. And in 1967, I entered my first foster home. In 1968, I entered my second foster home. The statistics said that a black boy in the Massachusetts foster care system, black boy, there was a 70% likelihood that they would end up where? In jail. 70% likelihood that a black boy in the Massachusetts foster care system would end up in jail. My path was a little bit different. I was adopted. I attended Yale University. I spent one of the best years of my life right down the street at Luther Place Shelter as part of the Lutheran Volunteer Corps. I graduated from Harvard Law School, and I now have 31 beautiful nephews and nieces. Pretty nice, huh? So, but why me? Well, clearly my parents, who after having 7 children of natural birth, making the personal decision that they could raise another, clearly that's part of it. But clearly, one nonprofit, and ironically, it was a nonprofit that had been going through some real tough financial circumstances right before I was adopted. But somehow their leadership found a way to build a business model, to build an economic model that would allow them to stay strong, that it would allow their social worker to do her job, which was to screen and select families, to train families to find the right placement. And then obviously to make sure that I was good during the transition. That was my personal journey. And that journey led me to clearly understanding what my purpose in life was. I'd never know the answer, why me? But I certainly could turn that into, I'm going to use my life to help others the way folks I never know and will never know helped me. In the early stages of that journey, I looked and said, how can I turn this purpose and passion, how can I take my energy and actually turn it into action and turn it into a career? And I was really fortunate because I was at Harvard Law at that time and I was really struggling with this question of having purpose but really having no idea how to bring it to life. And so I went to the Office of Public Interest and they said, if you want to get involved in social justice, if you want to give back, if that's what you want to do, you should your second summer go to a law firm. You should just do it because you should have that experience. But the office said that your first summer, why don't you do something different? And so they made the great suggestion, which I was not opposed to, that I go to Kingston, Jamaica for the summer. I said, Jamaica for the summer? That sounds really good to me. So I went down, I was working for the Jamaica Council for Human Rights. I was doing kind of death row work and habeas corpus and documenting police brutality. And I really, really enjoyed being part of such a phenomenal organization that was making such a difference. But I also missed something, and I missed being with children. So I went to my boss, Florizel O'Connor, and I said, could I just one afternoon a week go and volunteer and be with children? She said, I have the perfect place. Maxfield Park Orphanage. So I went over to the orphanage, and on Monday, 2 nuns interviewed me. They let me know that I had the job on the spot, and they said, come back on Thursday. So I went back on Thursday, and they said, Earl, we have some good news and some bad news. The good news is you're going to get tons of teaching experience. I said, well, that's wonderful. They said, the bad news is that the head teacher has quit, and so you're going to run the classroom now. So I protested. I said, I really don't know anything. And they said, well, you sent all these nephews and nieces. I said, yeah, but you get them excited, you send them back to your brothers and sisters. That's not education. And then I also said, you know, they said, well, Harvard and law. And I said, that doesn't teach you anything. But they resisted that, and they said, get in the classroom. So I went in the classroom, and this little girl came up to me. She's probably 5 years old. And she said, Mr. Phelan, how do I add 1 plus 1? Now, in fairness to me, I just come off a tough first year of law school, but my mind, I was just like, 1 + 1 = 2, like I can't, and so I couldn't explain it to her. And so another older girl came up to me and she said, no, you take one crayon and you take one pen, now count. And so the little girl said, 1, 2, 1 + 1 = 2. And her eyes lit up and she said, I'm smart. And at that moment, I had found my purpose in life. And so when the session ended, I went out to the phone, called my parents, had to be collect, but I called them collect, and I said, Mom and Dad, I'm dropping out of law school and I'm going into education. I'm gonna start a nonprofit that's focused on education. And my parents convinced me that maybe that wasn't the wisest choice and that maybe I should see my 3 years through. But they also advised me, why don't you use your time to reach out to the different professors in the various law schools, because I'm sure they'd be willing to help. So I reached out to Professor Ogletree, and he helped me kind of think about community and social change broadly. And I didn't know anything about education, so we reached out to Dr. Robert Peterkin, and he started to teach us and really kind of show us how we could really help children excel. And I reached out to Bailey Mason, who was head of Harvard's billion-dollar campaign, and he was nice enough to take all the time in the world to teach me how to learn how to fundraise. So we started this nonprofit, and I just want to pause for a second, and you guys may have talked about this already, so please excuse me, but how many nonprofits are there in the United States of America? How much? 700,000, any other guesses? About 1.5 million. 150 new nonprofits are started every single day. So I want to step back and get a sense of the sector first. 150 started every day. So you have organizations, 1.5 million. Of those, how many do you think have revenue of under $1 million? What percent have a revenue under $1 million? 90%. So just think about this from us. We're trying to make social impact, but our sector has 1.5. We're starting 150 new nonprofits every day. 90% are under $1 million revenue. Fewer than 2% have revenue of $20 million or more. And Stanford University did a study about a year and a half ago, and that study said that since nonprofits started since 1970, only 144 have grown to revenue of over $50 million. So if you think about that, those data points, you start to get a sense of what the executive director in most nonprofits are doing. And they are doing what? What are they doing? They're fighting to survive. These are folks who have better personal stories than I do, who have the solutions to some of the nation's most intractable problems, and their biggest concern is, how am I going to make payroll next week? That's where they're focused. So profit is power. The best thing that happened to my nonprofit organization when it got started was No Child Left Behind. So it was about 2003, 2004, we were serving about 1,000 children, summer and after school learning programs. And we went to several foundations and said, we're ready to go. We were in 3 states at that juncture. We're ready to grow to 500 additional children. The foundation said, whoa, slow down. 500's too many. The wheels are gonna come off. Quality's gonna unravel. And then No Child Left Behind happened. And a classmate actually who was in law school with me, but was probably smarter because he went to business school next, he started a for-profit organization in the same space. And his organization went from 0 children, non-existent, to 16,000 children in 18 months. Now, I'm somewhat competitive, and I was like, damn. I mean, come on, there's something there. Now, maybe they don't bring all the bells and whistles, but there's something there that they went from 0 to 16,000, and here we are getting praise and actually struggling to go from 1,000 to 1,500. So we made some really tough decisions about what our business model will be. And let me be really clear about business models, we're all in the same place, right? Business model is price of product is this, or service. The cost to deliver it is this. And the gap in between is revenue or surplus, depending on whether you're a for-profit or nonprofit. Okay? I know this sounds elementary. 99% of nonprofits, and up until that moment, our nonprofit did not operate that way. The price was this, the cost to deliver was this, and we had to go out and raise that every single year. So our scale was slow, 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 so slow. So we changed our business model, we flipped it up, and it was some hard choices. There were some really hard choices to get that price to fit in.
But our trajectory was we went from 2 million to 4, 4 to 9, 9 to 17 million, 17 to 23 million, 23 million to 27 million. 5 years, we went from $2 million organization to a $27 million organization. More significantly, we went from serving 1,000 scholars to serving 15,000 scholars, and every year our results increased, our impact increased. I now have the fortune of leading two nonprofit organizations, and they're two great organizations. One is called Reach Out and Read, and the other is called Summer Advantage, as Marina shared. Reach Out and Read works with young children, so children from birth to age 5, to make sure that they're ready and when they hit the schoolhouse doors to excel. We work with about 3.8 million children. We have 27,000 volunteer doctors who implement our program, and we're at 4,500 sites throughout the United States, 20-year-old organization. Summer Advantage, second organization, just piloted last summer, 1,000 scholars, and now we're in the process this summer to reach 5,000 scholars and do it in a way that's profitable. The only reason, and I'll jump back before jumping forward, when I was at 1,000 scholars, honestly, my soul was dying. Because every year there were thousands of kids who wanted our program, and I could not figure out, I was not smart enough to figure out a way to build our business to reach those children and families. And so now to be in a position to be blessed with doing what's beyond my wildest dreams, leading two organizations, serving nearly 4 million children, and having an impact on their lives, I come back to where I started, which is profit is social power. Thank you.